rest upon our hearts.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers here and around the world. Let us pray. Our Father and our God, we come this morning on this special day to say thank you for the blessings that you have bestowed upon us. You woke us up this morning, started us on our way. We had food, clothing, and shelter, and even in the midst of a pandemic and all of the other things that are going on around the world, you blessed us to assemble here once again today to say thank you for your love, your kindness, and your goodness. And God, we thank you for our mothers, those who have nurtured us, brought us into the world, nurtured us, and brought us to where we are today. And even though some have been called on home to glory, God, we still thank you for their legacy, because it's showing in their children's lives by those that are gathered here and those who may not be here but had a desire to come. We thank you, Lord, for our pastor and this congregation. Pray that you will keep them in your knowledge and in your care. We pray, my Father, for children around the world, those who may have a mother, those who may have lost their mothers one way or another. But we thank you, God, for bringing us back to reality. We thank you for bringing us and keeping us through the pandemic and all of the things that we're going through. We pray, Lord, that you will touch our hearts and touch our minds, open them to your word, where we would become doers instead of just hearers only. Pray now for this community, and we pray for a better tomorrow. And if that is to happen, Lord, we are the ones who are to stand in the gap and call sin out wherever we see it. Tell young men and women that Jesus died for our sins out on a hill called Calvary over 2,000 years ago, that we might have a right to the tree of life. Bless this congregation once again, Father. Keep the leaders and the members under your wings of protection. For we ask it all in the name of your Son, Jesus, and for his sake. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Won't you stand, please? This is our Apostle Creed. What is it that we believe? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Let's pray once again. Father God, we come once again before your throne to say thank you for the gifts that you have given us. We thank you, Lord, for those who gave, those who give consistently, those, my Father, who may find some reason not to partake of your bounty and your blessings. But God, we look at things through a dark lens, and we may not see your glory and your blessings that you are pouring out upon us. But we thank you for those who have the clear vision to make sure that things are taken care of, because a house cannot run unless it has some financial support. We need your support today. And we need your support consistently through the year. Please, Lord, open hearts and open minds that we may see the glory and the blessings in giving to you. We pray that you will bless these offerings and multiply them 10 times. In Jesus' name we pray. This is our altar call, and we know you can't come down to the altar in front, but if you want to, you can sit where you are, or you can kneel where you are. God answers prayer as long as it's sincere, and he's waiting to hear from each one of us. So please, in these trying times, Let us be sincere about what we do and what we say, and offer God some sincere prayer and worship. The altar is now open. Thank you.
said, when the two or three are gathered together in my name, that shall I be in the midst. God is here. His Holy Spirit is here. We don't have to invite him to come in because he's already in the house. We just thank God again as he has given us yet another opportunity to stand before this congregation and offer words of encouragement. I thank God, first of all. I thank Jesus Christ, his Son. I thank the Holy Spirit. I thank God the grave for giving me the opportunity to come again and to preach and give words of encouragement to a waiting congregation. And as we begin this message today, let us pray. And I pray for God, the Holy Spirit, who anoint me with his wisdom and his guidance, that I may give words of wisdom, words of encouragement, and words of uplifting, and words of relevancy to his people today. God, we come now in your presence. And we're thankful, God, that we are able to present our bodies as living sacrifices unto you. Thanking you, God, for all that you have done for us. And we know that we have come through many dangers, toils, and snares. But by your grace and your mercy, you have brought us through. And Father, we thank you that you have given us an opportunity to be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of our minds, that we may prove what is that good, perfect, and acceptable will of yours. And we thank you, God, that your Son Jesus came a Savior of this world, came not to do his own thing, but to do your will. Father, as we continue to serve you in spirit and in truth, let us be about the business of doing your will. Let us put our trust in you, Father, and in all ways let us acknowledge you so that you continue to direct our paths. And Father, we pray continually for your grace and your mercy. And we pray, O God, that as we deliver your word, that your word, O God, will bring comfort and peace to those who hear. And we know, O God, that the effectual fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. And let us be fervent about our prayers. Let us be righteous about our prayers, Father, for we know that we are your righteousness, and we were made your righteousness by your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you, O God, for the relationship we have with you through him. And we always give you praise, honor, and glory. Jesus' name. Amen. Today is a very special day. Today is Mother's Day. And I said that I probably would not give a Mother's Day message today. But how could I not? Because today is a day where we honor mothers. All mothers. And mothers are worthy of honoring. Just as the Holy Spirit gave us life when we were born, we were without life. As he breathed into us the breath of life, mothers who bore us gave us breath when we had no breath. God made something out of nothing because we were nothing until God made us, and he made us through our mother's womb. We have to think about that and think seriously. Today, my message is a mother's promise. A mother's promise. And that comes from the 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 11, and that is my text. But before I go into the message, I want to share with you something that I think it's important. There is a history of Mother's Day. And I want to just share this with you, because Mother's Day, in one form or another, was the daughter of a Methodist pastor, and we are Methodists. Jarvis felt that the scars of the Civil War could be healed by mothers and by honoring mothers. She died in 1905 before her dream of establishing a holiday could be fulfilled. But her daughter, also named Anna Jarvis, took up the crusade. Anna had been deeply influenced by her mother, and she often recalled hearing her mother say that she hoped someone would one day, someday, establish a memorial for all mothers, living and dead. Anna had been particularly touched at age 12 while listening to her mother teach a Sunday school lesson on the subject, Mothers in the Bible. Jarvis closed the lesson with a prayer to this effect. I hope and pray that someone, sometime, will found a memorial of Mother's Day. There are many days for men, but none for mothers. Anna never forgot that moment. And at their mother's graveside service, Anna's brother Claude heard her say, by the grace of God, you shall have that Mother's Day. Anna began a campaign to establish a National Mother's Day. She and her supporters began to write a constant stream of letters to ministers, businessmen, politicians, editors. She spent a fortune to try to attract the attention to her idea and took every opportunity to give speeches and send telegrams or write articles for the cause. On the second anniversary of her mother's death, May 12, 1907, Anna laid a tribute to her mother at Andrews Methodist Episcopal Church in Gapton, West Virginia. She donated 500 white carnations, her mother's favorite flower, by everyone in attendance. On this first Mother's Day service, the pastor used this text, Woman, behold thy son. Son, behold thy mother. It's John 19, 26 and 27. That same day, a special service was held at the Wanamaker Auditorium in Philadelphia, which could seat no more than a third of the 15,000 people who showed up. After that, things began to take off. Various states jumped on the bandwagon, officially proclaiming Mother's Day each year. In 1914, President Woodrow Wilson officially established Mother's Day, a national holiday to be held on the second Sunday in May. Today is the second Sunday in May, and today is Mother's Day, a very special day that we celebrate. We celebrate because we all have mothers. And we think about mothers. Mothers are very special. And mothers are a very integral part of the family. Because without mothers, we would not be here. But we are living in some difficult times, and bringing up children into a Christian environment with respect for God and parents seems almost an impossibility. There are many, there are so many evil influences and distractions in our society today. Even children from Christian homes are subject to become victims of deceit and entrapment. The task of bringing up children today is more than most mothers can handle without help. That is why Hannah had to take her son, took her son to church, took her son back to God, and dedicated his life to God, so that God will be our helper. Not only God, but those in the church, because it does take a village. Anna knew that even in her time, that raising children would be a difficult job, and she knew that she could not successfully perform without the help of the Lord. Eli, the priest in whose presence she was praying, she made a promise to God, had two evil sons who were very disobedient, and they had yielded to evil influences and had no respect for God or their father, and did evil in the sight of God because of their disobedience, sinful ways. Their lives were cut short. You know, as a commandment in the Bible, it says, honor thy father and thy mother. Thy days may be long in the land of the Lord thy God giveth thee. We have to honor mother. We have to honor father. But today is about mothers. Today is about the woman who made a promise to God, a mother's promise. statistics speak for themselves, but when mothers do not pray for God and ask for his help, do not make a promise to God to give their children back to him in sincerity, they open the door to a multitude of troubles, not only for themselves, but also for their children. We recognize that today in our society, for so many children are not in church, so many parents are not bring their children to church. So many mothers do not continue to pray for their children. But this is a day where mothers have that opportunity to pray for their children. Because children are indeed a gift from God. And we have to accept that God is concerned about the children. God is concerned that mothers are happy and not sad. God is concerned about children, and we know because when the disciples rebuked your little children for coming to Jesus, Jesus spoke, "Do not forbid them to come unto me, for such are the kingdom of God." These are the ones who enter into God's kingdom, so you don't want to try to keep them out. But Hannah was a wise mother, though it may seem that she was giving up her son to be raised by the church. The priest Eli, she really understood how important it was for a child to be brought up and nurtured in the church. All the evil influences that might have been against her son Samuel on the outside, she knew that God was on the inside. Great is he that is in you and he that is in the world. If God be for us, then who can be against us? The mother's promise is important to God. Because God recognizes that a mother who promises to bring a child to church, give him or her back to the Lord and see that that child serves him all the days of his or her life, is an acknowledgement of him as the Lord Almighty. God can do anything but fail. Bringing your children to church and having them brought up in their admonition of the Lord is a blessing to their lives. And it also gives them a fighting chance in a society so contaminated with evil and evildoers. Mothers, make your promises today. Your children are dependent on you. It is your Christian responsibility. When they're young, they don't fully understand that the devil can be wandering around in the earth, going back and forth in the earth. They don't realize that he's seeking someone that he can devour. They don't realize that he's seeking to destroy their lives because they're weak and defenseless. You see, the devil has come to rob, kill, and to destroy. But God sent his son Jesus here that we might have life more abundantly. The children need to know this. They need to know that the devil is the enemy. That the world is the enemy, but God is their friend, and God will take care of them. We need to let them know that the evil one wants them dead rather than alive. The wanted posters in the Old West would read, "Wanted, dead or alive." But the devil wants you dead, period. And children don't realize that unless you bring them church and give them back to God, that Jesus came into this world so they may have the life that God has promised. Even when you allow the world, and if you allow the world to bring up your children, and some do, after you have promised God that you will give them back to him, then the world will claim your children, and you won't be able to get them back. When they are old enough to make their own decisions, they will decide whether to serve God or to serve the world. You see, Joshua stood one day before his congregation. And he made him make a vow. Choose you this day whom you will serve. Will you serve the people on the other side of the flood? Or will you serve the people, the God that, or the people who you live among? When you serve the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, he said, "But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." And we're still going to serve the Lord because Hannah children to know that Romans 3:23 says all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But we can let them know that they can confess their sins. But God is a faithful God. God is a just God. God will forgive them of their sins and cleanse them from all unrighteousness. We need to let them know that the God we serve is a God of love, a God of kindness. Mothers who are sad today don't have to remain sad. Just follow Hannah's example. Just to let God know that you are satisfied, that you have done everything to extend your faith into the life of your children, then you will know without a doubt that God has heard your prayer. God has acknowledged your promise. Your heart will be filled with gladness rather than sadness, and you will feel very strong in the Lord. God is our all in all. Mother's promise. This is what we need to understand today. When you make a promise, keep your promise. Because God is a promise keeper. And there are many today who are calling on God. And we sing that song sometimes, "Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry.
Yes.
Wow, brothers, thou art calling. Do not pass me by."
Yes, sir.
And I promise you that God will hear your humble cry. And he will not pass you by. He has many who are calling upon him. But just trust in him and trust that he will understand. Because God understands that we are weak, but he is strong. We are often tempted to yield to temptations. But God is testing our faith. God wants to be assured that we who come to him believe that he is. And he is the reward of those who diligently seek him. God will reward us. It might not happen in the time that we want. But it will happen in God's time. But God's time is not our time. But I know one thing. He's always on time. God is good. Let us continue to honor our mothers. Honor our mothers because, mothers, you are special. Yes. And we know that you make many sacrifices for the children, your children, and other children. And I want you to know that you don't have to be a biological parent to be a mother. Amen. Because there are many mothers who did not have children, but they were mothers to many children. And they have brought those children up in the way that they have received the blessings of the Lord. And all we have to do is to remember to make our promises to God and keep our promises. Let's not be backsliders because we have decided to follow Jesus. We have decided to place the cross before us and the world behind us. And we are not turning back. What God has done for others, let me rest assured that he will do for you. All you got to do is ask him, and he will. The door of the church is open. There might be someone here today who has not confessed God, the Father, Jesus Christ, his Son, and the Holy Spirit. You see, God has open arms. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you that labor, and are heavily laden, and I will give you rest." He has extended the invitation, and we know that Jesus is the way, he's the truth, and the life.
Yeah.
soul. My Savior God to thee. How great thou art. How great thou art. And when I hear singing like this, if you want to be seated, you're ready. But if I hear singing like this, I know that we serve a mighty God.
Tell any more stories. I'll say
save those for later. Because we know that